time marvelous pitching coach of the New York Mets. 14 years here at Shea Stadium. He is now a special assignment scout for the St. Louis Cardinals. We welcome back Rube Walker. And our first former Met will always be remembered for the 69 World Series, his two acrobatic catches and Game 3 home run sparked the Miracle Mets to their first World Championship. A former Rookie of the Year with the Chicago White Sox, a 12-year veteran, he makes his home here in New York, number 20, Tommy Agee. As a rookie in 1962, this sure-handed third baseman was named to the Major League All-Star team after hitting .288 with 17 home runs. That was with Kansas City. He came to the Mets in 67 and was the regular third baseman during his championship season. We used to say that year, never, never hang a slider to the glider, Ed Charles. And our next performer played 12 years of the National League, parts of three with the New York Mets. His finest season came in 1969 with the Pirates when he hit 28 home runs, 98 RBIs. But he made his mark with a record-setting performance, three home runs in a five-game World Series that lifted the Mets to a World Championship. He was the MVP of the 1969 series. Welcome back, Don Clendenin. As a rookie for the 69 Mets, this lefty swinger played a very vital role as a utility infielder. He contributed some timely hits during the stretch run. He tore things up in the LCS, hitting .385 against Atlanta. He was the regular third baseman for the 73 pennant winners, hitting a career-high 16 home runs. He joins us from his home in Sarasota, Florida, Wayne Garrett. And this next man, well, he was the starting catcher for both the 69 Miracle Mets, the 73 National League champions. What a great handler of young pitchers. A marvelous defensive backstop, good clutch hitter, a two-time All-Star. Tom Seaver used to call him my catcher. Jerry Grody. And our next player was the first Met to start in an All-Star game. He did it right here in Shea in 1964. A gritty second baseman for 4 years with the Mets. He did whatever he had to do to get on base. Do you know he was hit by pitches? A National League record 243 times and a single season record 50 times he was hit in 1971. In 12 major league years, a lifetime average of .273, now makes his home in St. Louis, Ron Hunt. Boy, here's a gritty little left-hander. He was the early day ace along with Roger Craig. Our next player spent 5 of his 11 big league years in New York. In between stints with the Mets, he pitched for the World Championship Cardinals, had a 9-4 record in 67. He has worked as a major league pitching coach, now working as a minor league pitching instructor for the Mets. Won't you welcome back Al Jackson? Well, here's one of the Mets all-time leading hitters. His .281 career average highlighted and is still a team record, .340 for the Miracle Mets of 69. 14 years of the majors, all 12 of those with the New York Mets. He's second in club history in hits, doubles, and RBIs, and first in runs scored. We can all remember that fly ball to left field off the bat of the current Mets manager, Davey Johnson, landing in this man's glove for the final out of the 69 World Series. Here from Mobile, Alabama, Cleon Jones. Well, the man who tossed that final World Series pitch is certainly one of the greatest pitchers the Mets have ever had. Wonderful left-hander, He is in the top two of virtually every team pitching category. He went 17-9 during the championship year, and then he won two games in the World Series. He was traded to Minnesota and won 20 games there in 1979. And when he retired, 222 Major League victories, one of the best left-handers ever. Welcome back from his home in Minnesota, Jerry Kuzman. Well, this gentleman is the club's all-time leader in games, hits, and RBI. A native New Yorker, he spent his entire 18-year career in his hometown. He became the team's regular first baseman back in 1964, a key contributor to the winning team in 69. He hit 300 on two occasions and eventually became one of the top pinch hitters in the game. His 486 pinch hit average in 74, well, that's an all-time season best. Welcome, Eddie Cranepool. Eddie. A sure-handed second baseman, our next man was a three-time All-Star and two-time Gold Glove winner. He was such a great hit-and-run man, marvelous bat control. He spent 7 years with the Braves, five with the New York Mets before retiring. He hit 290 on that 73 pennant-winning team. Won't you welcome back Felix Mian. After hitting 300 during the regular season in 1969, he was one of the major stars of the World Series victory. Imagine this, a 538 average. This left-handed power hitter tied a National League record in 66 by hitting home runs in four consecutive times at bat, including three in one ball game. He's now a broadcaster and a restaurant owner in New York and a terrific guy, Art Shamsky. The highlight season of this next player's 9-year career also came in 69. During that campaign, you've read about it, you've remembered it. He smashed a pair of two-run homers to defeat Steve Carlton. And in that game, Carlton struck out 19 batters, but he did not win. His 400 batting average and game-saving catch in Game 4 of the World Series made him the talk of the town. He finished his career across town with the Yankees. Now a very able TV sports announcer living in New Orleans. Welcome back, Ron Swoboda. Now this gentleman was probably the most unlikely of Mets heroes in 69. He hit only 215 during the regular season, but he became a super sub in the World Series, batting 455 with several key hits. His ninth inning single won game two. His game five home run of the seventh inning tied the fifth game. A quality utility infielder for 10 years, but a Met fan dream for a week. What a player in that World Series in 69. Let's welcome Al Weiss. Our next two players are members of the Mets Hall of Fame. For 11 years, he was the Mets' regular shortstop. 11 years of defensive excellence, spectacular fielding, heads-up base running, timely hitting. From 67 to 77, this switch hitter was truly the cornerstone of the Mets' infield. He is second in games, third in hits on the club's all-time list. A two-time All-Star and Gold Glove winner, he has been a key man of the organization since retiring in 1980. Now a coach for Davey Johnson, let's save a big hello for Buddy Harrelson. You know, for 23 years, our next player made life miserable for major league pitchers. He could hit. After breaking in with Houston when he was 19 years old, he became one of the game's most consistent hitters, hitting over 300 four times. He lifted the Mets to the World Series in 73 by hitting three home runs in the championship series against the Reds. He batted 423 of the series after returning to the Mets in 1981. After he came back to the Mets in 1981, he became a pinch hitter, the likes of which we hadn't seen. He retired in 85, and listen to the number. When he retired, he had 2,716 hits, a .279 batting average, Rusty Staub. Now let's meet our final guest and the newest member of the Mets Hall of Fame. He will be inducted tomorrow. One of the all-time great pitchers. A 300-game winner. The man they call the franchise. Rookie of the Year in 67. Three Cy Young Awards. The best the Mets have ever had. Tom Seaver. Gentlemen, the Mets Old Timers. Since you're all already standing, we'll ask you to please remain standing. Major League Baseball has lost several members of what we consider a very special family. And on this reunion occasion,
and every time they got in the World Series, Brooks was like a star on opening night. He would play for the Orioles, took hits away from the Reds in that one series. Remember, they couldn't believe what was happening to them.
A tremendous, tremendous career in Baltimore. Of course, Brooks, he batted over around 11,000 times. And of course, I believe that's fourth in the history of baseball. Pete Rose with more than anybody. And right now, Ralph Garr will lead it off for the Equitable Old Timers.
They called him Flip Wilson when he played because he looked so much like Flip, but he was a good singles hitter for the Braves for a long time. Gave the Mets a lot of fits.
And how about those stats? A .306 lifetime hitter? And that's exactly how he's
right into the first pitch.
Like just like always.
He hasn't changed, has he? That's where he got a lot of those hits. That fastball came in there and Ralph took care of it.
You know, looking at the old timers, a lot of them are in great shape.
Well, these aren't really old like you see some of the old timers. Some of these players only finished their career a couple of years ago.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, but the old timers at the All-Star game were 25 years retired, a lot of them.
Yeah, and of course, I guess the record for a home run by an old timer, Luke Appling at 75 years old. This could get serious,
Ralph.
Looks
like Tom thinks he's still in the playoffs in 69.
Of course, that was a great playoffs right here at Shea Stadium, the Braves and the Mets.
Tom won the first game in Atlanta.
And of course, Ralph Garr led the Braves in 79 with a .353 average. He had 17 triples that year.
He could run. Well,
by the way, I don't believe there's any striking out here in the Equitable Old Timers game.
Everybody got to get a chance to hit.
I'll tell you, I heard a great story about one of these games. Hank Aaron was the hitter. As Garr fouls that ball off. And Hank Aaron, it was in either Milwaukee or Atlanta. Of course, Hank
he wanted to be good in those two.
Sure. And the umpire called him out on strikes. The people from Equitable couldn't believe it as he walked back to the dugout.
That's a Ralph flare.
That's how Ralph used to hit him.
And that's the way Buddy used to go back and get him, too.
Yes. And Buddy Harrelson, of course. Buddy looks like he could play today.
Well, of course, he's in great shape working out with the Mets infielders every day. He probably could play some sort of those knees held up.
Yeah. How about this guy, the batting number two for the Equitable Old Timers, a guy who, his son's having a great year.
He either just tied or broke his record or something on leadoff home runs. He held the record for leadoff home runs. I think somebody just broke it or tied it. I think Ricky Henderson tied it the other night.
And Bobby Bonds in great shape. He had a great career.
He was going to be the heir apparent to Willie Mays, but Willie kept on playing.
That's right. How about 332 home runs for a leadoff hitter?
That's down. Oh.
And he can hit that either.
He can still play.
Yes, he could still play. Bobby.
He could run, too. That was a great thing, Bobby.
You know, we talked about the 30-30 club last year. Now, here's what Bobby did so well with the Giants. Bang, home run. I shouldn't say home run. Hit the ball a mile over the center field wall here. That ball was hit at Candlestick Park in San Francisco. He looks like he could still play.
He hit a lot here, too, because he played for when he was traded for Bobby Mercer. He played here for a couple of years and played for the Yankees, hitting home runs.
Had some fine years. I think one of the things that hurt his reputation as far as his career was he was traded so much. And here's Brooks.
There goes AJ.
Oh!
Thank goodness that didn't happen in 69.
And Brooksy's probably saying, why couldn't you have done it in 69?
Hit it to Swoboda.
Look at this, Brooksy.
That's Brooks asking, why didn't you do that in 69?
Oh, nobody did it better, and what a classy guy, Brooks Robinson.
You notice that?
Look at this. Always in motion. And here's Ernie Banks fouling the ball back off of Tom Seaver.
He's getting his dream. He came into the clubhouse to me and said, we're going to play two today. He always wants to play a doubleheader.
Love those doubleheaders. 19 years. That's a 19 major league campaign.
You know, I don't know if anybody played that enjoyed the game more than he did. He truly enjoyed playing every day.
And Ernie Banks pulls this ball.
Just foul.
Foul. And Charles unable to catch a foul ball. You know, talking about doubleheaders, Jack. Talking about doubleheaders, I had the opportunity to go out after the ball game the other day with Brooks Robinson and Harmon Kilgore. They remind me of Ernie Banks. They love to play the game. They said they like playing doubleheaders.
A doubleheader in Chicago had to be a dream.
Oh,
you got a chance to go after those fences twice.
That's right. He did it so well, didn't he? Look at those fingers still moving as he swings. No strikeouts. Ernie gets the hit.
Yeah.
Of course, Ernie Banks, one of nine guys who won the Most Valuable Player Award.
I know the night I called him to tell him he was in the Hall of Fame. He flew in from the Midwest somewhere. He arrived at about 1 o'clock, around midnight, and he wouldn't go to sleep. He stayed up all night long. We were over in the Sheraton Center Hotel those times, and he kept pacing the floor. And finally, he said to me, when can I call my old buddy Gene Baker? And I said, well, you got to wait until the morning. So he waited until the morning, 5 o'clock. He called Gene Baker, but Gene Baker was in Iowa, and it was 3 o'clock in the morning. Then he called Eddie Matthews on the West Coast, and it was 2 o'clock in the morning.
Jack, what is the reaction that stands out in your mind, because you call these guys who are elected to the Hall of Fame as Banks pops the ball up, and you can bet Buddy will catch it.
It's just, you know, it's like a whole new life begins for them all. I mean, and it does, really, because most of them are at least 5-6 years retired when they happen, and now all of a sudden they're going to get the adulation from the fans and from the public again, and they're going to have those moving ceremonies in Cooperstown. I have yet to call anybody that wasn't just, this was the moment in their life.
Were you ever surprised as you look at Billy Williams, a guy I'm sure you had a call? Call them all.
Yeah, I called him.
You never called me.
You sound like Joe Garagiola. Just call me, even if I'm not in. Just call me and say, hello, Jack, how's the family? And it's a ritual now. I've been calling him for about five years. Yeah.
Oh, that's funny.
Called him in Arizona, and he was in Palm Beach when I called him last winter, and he made his whole routine that night. He was speaking at some dinner. He said, I got my call from Jack Lang today. He said, because I'm still not in.
That must be a great feeling.
It's a great feeling for me, too.
Oh, boy. Yeah, I can imagine. It must be very happy for everybody else. How about that Billy Williams getting
Billy
the umpire
Williams
to move? What's going on here? They're taking this seriously.
Well, he took the game seriously. You knew that what kind of hitter he was.
Yeah, he was a great to watch. They had the shift on for him, and he pops up. Buddy Harrelson doing the job.
Buddy. Seaver got a lot of ass when Buddy was behind him, and it's the same old thing today.
Yeah, at the Old Timers, Equitable Old Timers game, and Jack Lang and I will be back in just a moment. have a sellout crowd following this. The Mets take on the Braves, and Tommy a little bit out in front of Fergie Jenkins. By the way, you just tuned in, a lot of Hall of Famers here. The gentleman who calls them is in the booth, Jack Lang. Jack covered the New York Met baseball team from 62 to 86. As A.G. hits a fly ball center field, there goes Bobby Bonds, and he gloves it.
He was right there, too.
Yeah.
You know, Tommy A.G. did something other than the great catches that most people remember him for. He's the only man that's ever put one in the upper deck just inside the foul pole at Shea Stadium. Nobody else has ever reached that area.
You mean the red seats?
The red seats where you see the people in the green shirts, that's where he hit
it.
On an afternoon game that was a getaway game for the Mets, he put one up there. I think Larry Jastrow, I think, threw the pitch.
Wow.
The only man ever to hit one up there.
And here's a guy who's had...
Oh, well, marvelous. What now, thrills he gave the fans here.
Do you think you'll, think you'll ever be calling him, Jack?
I hope so. I think as an individual and as a ball player, he was a Hall of Famer. I think everybody that knows Rusty just uses the word class behind his name.
Okay, now Rusty's been thrown out by a whole lot right
well,
there.
Well, he was thrown out by a lot of steps a lot of times.
Hey, now there's the manager of the team. I got to... Ralph Kiner, who works, does a great job up here in the booth. And Ralph, how can you possibly bat Ralph Garr ahead of Bobby Bonds? With all the home runs Bobby Bonds has hit over the years?
Well, we had a big debate about it. And the fact that Ricky Henderson has tied him now at 35 leadoff home runs, we called the commissioner's office, and he said that if he hit a home run leading off in this ball game, it wouldn't count. So we thought we'd put Ralph Garr up there because of his great speed.
Okay.
I thought you were going to say you had a discussion about it and you lost. Like a lot of managers do these days, Ralph.
Well, I haven't received any information at all from the administrative part of this team.
And here's a guy Ralph called many a shot off of his bat, Cleon Jones.
One of the purest hitters that the Mets ever developed, really. I mean, he was... tremendous player. I think a lot of people feel he might have gotten more out of his talent, but that one season, 1969, he was a tremendous hitter, 340.
Well, did an outstanding job for the Mets. Of course, one of those guys who catches or throws left-handed and bats right-handed.
You know, the thing that a lot of the old-time Met writers and fans will remember, he was the victim of probably one of the most embarrassing scenes ever on a baseball field. It was in August of 69, and Gil Hodges, who was a strict disciplinarian, he didn't think that Leon gave it all his effort on one ball out in the corner. The Mets were taking a terrible beating from Houston. And Gil walked out of the dugout, and he kept walking past the mound, walked past the shortstop, walked all the way out to left field, and he said to Cleon, "Are you all right?" And Cleon said, "Yeah." He said, "I don't think you are, not the way you played that last ball. Come with me." Gil turned around, and Cleon followed him all the way back to the dugout.
That's incredible.
Didn't play for the next couple of days.
Yeah, that's an incredible incident as Bobby Bonds makes the catch.
But Cleon was... Cleon was a good outfielder.
Very good outfielder. There's Cleon making some catches right here, throwing the ball in, getting the ball back into the infield. And once again, you're watching the Equitable Old Timers game right here on Sports Channel. And we're going to stay here, and we're going to talk to our colleague down in the dugout, Ralph Kiner. And Ralph, last week in Boston, there was an embarrassing incident when Jim Rice, who's as strong as an ox, went into the dugout and grabbed a hold of Joe Morgan. Look at this. Ralph's going over the lineup. Ralph, they're not listening to you. Hey, Ralph?
Yeah, I got you.
Now, let me ask you, Joe Morgan had an altercation with Jim Rice the other day in the dugout over being pinch hit for. Will anything like that transpire today concerning you and a player?
On a very friendly basis down here.
Making that lineup out by committee, I think.
And Ralph doesn't want any physical altercation down there in the dugout. Now, Ralph, what about Jerry Kuzman? Give us some of your thoughts on Kuz. Ralph, if you can hear us, jump up and down. Okay. What about Jerry Kuzman, Ralph?
Be up against Jerry Kuzman.
Ralph, yeah, he can hear us. I don't think the mic's working. Ralph, take the mic and throw it off the wall. That'll help. Can you hear us? Ralph, put your right hand up if you hear us. Now put your left hand up if you hear us. Now jump up and down.
You didn't say Simon says.
Okay, we can hear you now. What about Jerry Kuzman?
Jerry Kuzman, I talked to him before the ball game. Of course, Jerry, a part of the great combination.
Okay, and how about this guy right here, Dick Grote? Great player with the St. Louis Cardinals.
Great clutch shortstop. And a great, probably one of the best men hitting behind the runner. Going to the right field.
Most valuable player in the National League.
National League, right. outstanding with two good ball clubs, St. Louis and Pittsburgh. There's a glider, the little glider used to be.
So Ed Charles.
He can still do it.
tipped his hat. Threw the ball over to Clendenin at first base.
It brings up Campy and Campanera.
So Dick Rota was named the MVP in 1960 by the Baseball Writers Association of America. Is now heading back to the dugout. And the batter is a guy, Bert Campaneris, was an outstanding player with the Oakland A's.
Isn't he the guy that, with, when he was in Kansas City, that Finley had to play all nine positions one day?
Yes.
In one of the last game of the season, he played every position. That's how versatile he was.
He was a great player. Yeah. Great player.
And a good hard player. I mean, he was played every day.
He could run. He was the motor in that Oakland A ball club, stealing bases, playing shortstop. And Kuzman threw the ball right by him. Jerry Kuzman throwing hard here at Shea Stadium. And Bert Campaneris hits the ball down left field line. A base hit for Camp. He's going for two. Just like he used to.
I didn't like to put one on the green like that.
Oh, boy.
Stop 3 feet from the cup.
Oh. And Bert hit that ball as hard as he could right there. He was a fine player with the Oakland A's.
He was in a bunch of no-hitters. 8 or 9, 11, something like that. Played well, of course, he had the pitching in front of him that could pitch no-hitters.
Yeah. And how about this guy, the guy that revolutionized catching, Randy Hundley. Jerry Kuzman pitching to the guy who started the one-handed catching. Thank God.
You're not mad at it if you had to use two hands.
Oh, my. I'll tell you, it's interesting. Johnny Bench, a lot of people feel Johnny did. I was talking to Johnny the other day, and he gave all the credit to Randy Hundley.
Yeah, Randy was a great catcher. He was an outstanding catcher on that 69 Cup team that the Mets beat out. I can remember every time he came up in Wrigley Field, they played Dixie. He was a big, and he waved Dixie flags and everything.
Well, he picks up a hit to right field.
You know what he's famous for now? He's the man, I think, that started the fantasy camp.
That's exactly right.
He's run fantasy camps all over the country. Yeah. He's given a lot of would-be ball players a lot of late thrills.
Yes, he is. Now, how about Rocky Ron Swoboda?
Well, Ron Swoboda, the first time that Casey Stengel saw him in spring training, I think it was 64, he said, this boy can hit a baseball over a building. And, of course, that year, the year he came up with the Mets, the first year he stayed with the Mets, he hit 15 home runs by the All-Star game, and it looked like he was going to be the all-time home run champ because he only hit four the rest of the way. But Ron was a good, solid ball player. In 69, he and Art Shamsky shared right field. That was the two platoon positions that Hodges used, first base and right field. And Swoboda and Shamsky playing right field hit something like 25 home runs and dove in 95 runs. And Crane Pool and Clendenin at first base did the same thing. So out of those two positions, he got almost 50 home runs and almost 200 RBIs.
Ron Swoboda right now, a sportscaster in the New Orleans area. Jimmy Pearsall, the batter, kind of an interesting character.
He hit that 100th home run at the Polo Grounds. He had promised us he was going to do something different. And before the game, when he hit the homer, he said something to the umpire. And the umpire shook his head. And he told us later what he wanted to do. Of course, he ran around the bases backwards. What he wanted to do was go from third to second to first to home. He wanted to run backwards all the way. No, he couldn't do that. The umpire said it wouldn't be right, so he just turned around and ran down to first, backwards, second, and first. The Polo Grounds fans went crazy. There wasn't much else to cheer about in those days.
But so did Casey. He went crazy too, didn't he? Yeah,
Casey was crazy because he didn't think of it. Yeah, Casey thought that he was upstaging him a little bit. It was shortly thereafter that Pearsall was the next Met.
But here was a guy who enjoyed many a year with the New York Mets, Jerry Kuzman. And talking about Jimmy Pearsall, of course, the year of Bo Durham, a couple of years ago, the natural. Watch this guy catch a foul ball. He could do it with the best of them.
Seaver has said he was the best defensive catcher. He's going to push the umpire out of the way.
Ralph Garr coming up to him.
Yep.
And the guy who catches
that.
The guy who catches with the Mets now can catch a pop foul with the best of them too, Gary Cole.
Oh yeah, yeah. But I think even your colleague Tim McCaver has said on occasion that Jerry Grody was the best defensive catcher he ever saw.
Johnny Bench told me that the other day too. So Kuzman goes inside.
He did that a few times.
Oh, I heard he was tough.
1969, he did that on Ron Santo and it changed the whole pennant race around.
Ha, ha, ha.
You know, in 69, Seaver won his last 10 in a row, and I think Kluzman won 10 out of 12. So their last 22 starts, they won 20 ball games.
Listen to Jack Lang, who covered the New York Mets from 1962 to 1986. And here's Jack reminiscing about the Mets. And Ralph Garr takes up high. Jerry Kluzman, they all look in pretty good shape out there.
Yes, they do.
And Garr hits the ball out in front of the plate.
Hurry up, Kitty.
Oh, he throws it away. And all the old timers have to run. They're forced to run the bases.
I see Callison walked the last 10 steps.
I mentioned Tim McCarver. Tim will be joining us in the booth in another end of the inning. Of course, Tim played against a lot of these guys. Had to call pitches against Bobby Bonds, who will now bat. There's Ralph Garr. I was talking about Jimmy Pearsall. There was a story made about his life called Fear Strikes Out.
Yeah, Tony Perkins played it. Quite a story.
Carl Malden played the role.
If you stay up late at night sometimes, you can still see it.
Jimmy lived in Waterbury, Connecticut. Bobby Bonds, who led the Giants in 7 offensive categories in 71.
Oh,
boy. Up into the seats with the bat. And luckily, nobody injured, but they were going to fight about the bat.
Everybody all right? Getting that bat back. Keep it to Howard.
Well, Bobby doesn't care. It's not his gamer.
Oh, but don't tell me that. Keep it.
Keep Bobby it. Just wants to make sure they're all right.
That child is taken out of the room.
Watch this. Ooh, boy. You got to be aware of your surroundings here at any ballpark.
Baseball? You see that with Dave Winfield a lot.
Oh, yeah.
Many times the professors understand.
Well, they're going to keep the bat. Bobby walked all the way over to the dugout just to make sure the fan was all right. 30 home runs and 30 stolen bases 5 times. Last year, Darryl Strawberry and Howard Johnson did it
right.
For the Mets. This guy did it 5 times.
Tremendous ball player.
He missed the 40-40 club by a home run. And fouls the ball off.
It's an interesting scene. John Kibler's out there, veteran National League umpire. He came out to see these guys
yeah.
Too because, you know, yeah, now he's going to
get the ball off the field.
Oh, I thought he was going to come out and throw it.
No, he's throwing. Oh, I thought he threw the ball in the seats. Umpires won't do that.
No. That's a no-no with them.
Yeah. And Bobby fouls the ball off. Bobby Bonds, as Jack Lang mentioned, had some fine years here in New York with the Yankees. Played very well against the Mets. Takes up high from Jerry Kluzman. You can't strike out in this game, you know. This is the type of game they're playing. I wish they had that rule when I was playing.
Yeah. I think Bobby Bonds does.
Yes,
he struck out a few
times. Speaking of striking out, Bobby was a great fastball hitter. Yep. Hits a fastball right there.
There's the glider coming in, Charles.
And he makes the catch, like swimming, you never forget. Well,
right.
We want to thank you, Jack, for joining us here for the old-time festivities and sharing your memories.
I think it's the 21st of August.
So Gaylord Perry, who, oh boy, one of the toughest competitors I've ever played with, Gaylord Perry, pitched for a lot of ball clubs, won the Cy Young Award with the Cleveland Indians, is Don Clendenin. Loops on the right field in front of Ralph Garr for a base hit.
Don, a lawyer now. It was Don's 3-run homer the night of 1969, the clincher, when Steve Carlton had been telling me for 4 days that they weren't going to clinch it off of him. And they clinched it off of him. There's Gaylord's last out in the no-hitter. Boy, that's a great shot. Nice going, guys.
There's Jay Johnstone bringing water out to Gaylord. A bucket of water.
Very interesting that Gaylord would wear a Texas Ranger uniform,
yeah.
Isn't it?
I always remembered him as a Giant, although I faced him with the Indians, and he had some great career.
Checked the wrong ball.
Gaylord didn't use water. He used KY jelly because it wouldn't stain your uniform. Oh, he throws it, rides full boat after he has the ball checked. And Rocky hits a drive to left field. Billy Williams in pursuit.
That's Billy moving around well, isn't he?
get some Hall of Famers in this game. How about Brooks Robinson was here, and he had to catch a plane from Minneapolis.
Well, he could catch anything.
Yes, he did. He caught the plane in his glove.
Good play by Billy Williams. Tom Seaver was telling me before the game that they were standing around talking during batting practice today, and they were talking to Robinson, and a line drive was hit toward Brooksy. He short hopped it, caught the ball, threw it toward the mound without even breaking stride. He didn't even quit talking.
How about Bill Robinson? Making a catch on the foul ball that was hit off the bat of Ed Charles, and Ed refuses to leave the batter's box. I like these rules.
Doesn't count in this game.
That's right. I was telling a story before.
He said, look at Ed. Ed said, I didn't come all this way to foul out. You've got to be kidding me. The glider.
And Gaylord throws him a breaking ball. That's nasty. Ed Charles, a poet. He can hit.
Can write about it.
So Tom Seaver coaching down at first base.
Now, Jerry Grody.
Runners on first and second. It is Tom. He's telling Ed Charles how to hit. And Jerry Grody, the batter.
Best defensive catcher I ever saw. Slight edge over Bench. Bench, the better all-around catcher, obviously because of his power and run production. But this guy could flat catch.
And he hits one in the hole, cut off by Bill Robinson, and they get the force at second base. There's one of your teammates.
Not only one of my teammates, but one of my mentors, Richard Morrow Grote. I think I learned more baseball from Dick Grote than any other player.
I'm surprised he didn't manage him in the major league.
Yeah, I am too. I really am. Classy guy, All-American at Duke University, signed with the Pirates, roomed with Ralph Kiner. Ralph Kiner was his first roommate. MVP in 1960 with the Pittsburgh Pirates, and he missed 6 weeks of the season.
Gaylord's pitch to Felix Mian is a strike or a ball. We're not real sure anymore. 12 years a pro. Played 3 years in Japan. And he fouls the ball off. Talking about Ralph Kiner, Harmon Killebrew the other night said that the best advice he got was from Ralph Kiner when he was a kid with the Washington Senators. Ralph Kiner told him, get up on a plate. And he said it helped him throughout his career. And Killer went on to hit 573 home runs. And a ground ball to Campy. He goes to Dick Grote for the force. That'll do it for the Mets, old timers. And you're watching the Equitable Old Timers game. And Tim McCarver talked about Jerry Grote. Here's some action. Look at Grote behind the plate. Come out of the chute. Throw to second. On the money. Was that Davey Lopes he threw out?
I think it was, and it's Tom Gorman, the National League umpire. This one, an easy play. And I don't know who that is. Looks like a Philadelphia Philly, but Jerry Grody could throw, he could catch, call a game. He was an outstanding defensive player.
Talking to Johnny Bench, he seconded your motion that Grody was the best defensive catcher in the league. In fact, Bench surprised me. He was talking about Randy Hundley, who was also in this game, and Bench was almost signed with the Chicago Cubs, and I said, what do you think your career would have been like? He said, I don't know. They might have moved me to another position because of Randy Hundley.
Well, Randy Hundley was an outstanding catcher, and I think the first of the one-handed catchers.
Yeah, he was.
But he wasn't as good as this guy. This guy could really catch.
Catch, throw, call a game. Tom Seaver, as Bob Murphy said, refer to him as his catcher. Grody, of course, signed with the Houston Astros. Came over to trade.
He signed with the Colt 45. It was before the Astros, before their inception. And Al Jackson traded after the 1965 season for Kenny Boyer. Or was that Charlie Smith for Kenny Boyer? Al came to the Cardinals. Maybe it was Charlie Smith and Al Jackson for Kenny Boyer.
You know, you're talking about those Colt 45, Jerry Grody, the catcher, the two guys here today that played in the youngest major league lineup in the history of baseball. One was Jerry Grody, and the other was Rusty Staub with the Colt 45. Now here's Bill Robinson. Bill Robinson will lead off this inning. A young Bill Robinson right there.
Bill, the last Pirate to hit three home runs in a game. He did it back in 1976. I don't know if that was the game or not. Boy, do I remember that.
Nice play.
He was out, too. He never touched the plate. Dutch Ritter was behind the plate.
What a fly ball left field. Leon Jones there makes the catch. Let's see that throw.
Yeah, we got to see that one more time. It was a great throw, and I'll guarantee you, Bill Robinson never touched the plate. He went over me.
They call him out?
Huh? Of course, I never tagged him either. I haven't tagged him yet.
We'll go downstairs right now. It's up.
I said, Dutch, I held on to the ball. How can he touch the plate? I was on the plate. He went over me. I really don't know whether he touched the plate or not. That's what I argued, though.
But he didn't change the call.
No, he didn't.
Why are you looking at Ernie Banks?
Collisions like that are the reason that I wake up on humid mornings with my neck bothering my knees and my lower back.
And Tommy Agee's here at the ballpark today.
I saw him.
He was very close to you.
He was a lot. Who was the toughest guy that ever slid to you?
You'll never believe it. I'll tell you after we see this. You won't believe who's the toughest guy. Now here is Ernie Banks, number 500.
Wrigley Field. Look at those that old footage. Isn't that great?
Oh, that is great footage. Courtesy of Major League Baseball, I'm sure. We'll get some great footage over there. There's Ralph Kiner, Ernie Banks, and Billy Williams, the batter, talking about getting hammered at home plate. A guy named Danny Thompson, who about a year later died of leukemia. He was sick at the time. In Yankee Stadium, there was a throw to the plate. And, you know, you're bracing yourself, but you get to figure this gentleman here is ill. And he hit me. I couldn't believe it.
Look at this.
Ball's out of here. No, off the wall.
Sweet swinging Billy. I mean, a pee to right field. I don't think I've ever seen that in an old timers game. I mean, this ball is smoke. Watch this swing.
Great swing.
Boy, look at his head. Oh, man. Doesn't matter, Billy, whether you get out of the box or not. You keep hitting them like that.
What a pretty swing.
Same swing years ago. He knows this one's gone. Billy Williams, 426 lifetime homers.
And here's a guy who became a pretty good hitter over the years, Jay Johnstone. Made himself into a fine hitter. Jay, of course, now quite a character.
The Jay of Johnstone, author of two books.
I didn't know Jay could write.
He did. Ghost. Did the same thing I did.
I thought you guys were doing that yourself.
No, you didn't.
Jay popping the ball up. Eddie Crane Pool going back and making the catch. So, well, you saw Billy Williams yesterday, and you're going to see him today. You're going to see both. Here's yesterday.
Look at the head, the head. Oh, what a great swing. My gosh, now here's today.
Watch the head.
Look at the head, it's the same swing. That's wonderful. It's the same swing.
Another Hall of Famer, Billy Williams.
Man, was he a joy to watch. Every time he would come up to the plate, he kept about a quarter of a stick of gum in his mouth. Not a half a piece, not a full piece. And it was ritualistic for him to spit the gum up in the air and hit it with the barrel of the bat. And I never saw him miss the stick of gum.
Is that right?
I never saw him miss it. Spit it up and whack it on the barrel of the bat. And there's a guy who hit a lot on the barrel of the bat.
Look at this stroke. Ralph had a great stroke, didn't he?
I'll say. Strong hands.
Still
Ralph
does.
Still has those strong hands. You can tell.
Boy, you know, Ralph didn't jog, really. I mean, he went around the bases.
No home run trot in those days. If you gave a trot in those days, you'd be on your back the next time up. Now it's almost a given that they stand in the box and watch it for about 2 seconds before they take off. Then it hits the top of the fence, and they're on second instead of third. Shorty, all right.
Did you catch him?
Caught Shorty in Philadelphia, 1971, 72, part of 70. Never had a sore arm.
It's hard to believe. 15
never
years.
Had a sore arm. Could go out, pitch two times out batting practice in spring training. He was ready to go for the season.
Yeah, that's incredible, really.
And never threw during the winter. Never did anything. Come in a little overweight most of the time in spring training. You see the crane.
But then Woody Fryman like that threw, never hurt his arm?
Yeah, right.
And he threw hard. Whew.
Shorty could eat you up as a left-handed hitter.
He's going to try to pitch to Tommy Agee, and Tommy hits a drive to left field. And Billy Weyers makes the play.
These guys are playing, aren't they?
Yes, they are.
They're hacking. All right, Tommy.
Tommy owns a restaurant here in Flushing.
His buddy and roommate, Cleon Jones, from Mobile, Alabama. Tommy, the rookie of the year in the American League for the Chicago White Sox in 1966.
Tommy Agee almost got traded to the Red Sox for Carl Yastrzemski.
Oh, really?
Prior to coming to the Mets. I've
never heard that story. All right. You know, this game evokes a lot of memories, obviously. But I can't tell you, Ron Hunt, a lot of the pitchers that are pitching to Hunter right now, and he's the batter right now, I can't tell you the pitchers in the National League that hated him.
Because he would get hit with the pitch.
I mean, hated him. There wasn't a dislike.
Genuine hate.
Thomas coaching third. He's arguing the play with Bill Robinson.
He was just coaching first. Now Buddy Harrelson's coaching first. He'll be out coaching second base next inning.
Tom's big day tomorrow.
Yeah, wow. Well deserved. Tom Seaver day here at Shea Stadium. And Bill Robinson makes the catch. Ron Hunt pops the ball up. And what a day tomorrow for this guy right here, Tom Seaver.
You know, nobody, we talked about how the memories were evoked for Ron Hunt. Nobody had any type of hateful feelings toward Tom Seaver. It was a matter of respect. Hunt was ornery. I mean ornery. He would intimidate anybody. Bob Gibson didn't matter. And they'd throw at him intentionally in a game that didn't mean anything. I remember Gibson throwing at him and then hitting him and said, take that. Add that to your record.
I remember Gaylord Perry getting him on purpose. Throwing him right in the rib cage. He said, you want to get hit here?
He wore that pad in the torso and tried to run her up as the rookie of the year in 1963 for the Mets.
He has a team, I believe, in the Midwest now that travels around.
Yeah.
Amateur.
It's a wonderful thing.
Yeah, it really is.
I was talking to Hunter about it before the game, and he's from Wentzville, Missouri, and he recruits college athletes for an amateur baseball program. They go everywhere. 2 years ago, they went to Holland, as a matter of fact, introducing baseball over there. And as you see, Bert Campaneris. But it's a terrific thing. They cannot make their team unless their grade point average is a 3. They have to have a B average to be on his ball club.
Wow.
It includes us out.
I've been out of that thing. Guaranteed. I'd have to start my old club. You're looking at a guy who made the Oakland A's go, Bert Campaneris. Boy, he could run. He could play short. And I believe he's the only guy in the history of baseball that pitched with his left arm and his right arm in the same game in a minor league, Bert Campaneris. Of course, I could be wrong. Five ball.
The unfortunate incident, of course, with Bert was when he threw the bat at Laron Legros. I believe it was the 73 playoffs, or maybe 71, against Detroit.
Laron Legros, 6'5".
Yeah. And Campy of small stature, but he was suspended, I believe, for 10 games at the start of the 1972 season.
Andy Huntley looks great, doesn't he?
Line drive.
He's been going to all those baseball camps.
Andy Huntley on with a base hit.
Now, his son's a great-looking prospect in the New York Met minor league system.
Exactly right.
A lot of games in the year, especially in Chicago.
Now, that might have been why Randy didn't last as long as he did. Leo DeRocher believed in keeping the same 8 guys, and a lot of people think that the 1969 season was salvaged early by the Cubs because Leo played too many guys.
Foul pop.
or
played the same eight guys too many times and didn't use enough of the extra men to where when August came and they wanted to reach back for a little extra, they didn't have it.
And the Mets came out and won it all, and one of the guys on the Mets right there, Eddie Crane, well, he reminds me of Robert Klein, the comedian, who's
a great comedian. Yeah.
Outstanding comedian. And Jimmy Pearsall, the batter. He's been a comedian, too, over the years. Beer strikes out. Great mover.
Beer has one and one right now. Carl Malden played Jimmy's father. Tony Perkins played Jimmy. And of course, Tony went on to Psycho fame after that.
Yes, he did.
Jimmy used to... saying that kind of tongue-in-cheek, obviously, but Jimmy used to talk with Harry Carey. He said, a lot of people are crazy. He said, I've got papers to prove it. He used to kid about it.
I'll tell you, I heard him one time, Freddie Patek, old-timers, came over talking to some of the Braves.
Ken Griffey and Tom were teammates in Cincinnati. Matter of fact, I think Griffey caught the last out when Tom threw his only no-hitter in 1979. I believe it was an infield out. Griffey caught it, or what? No, it was Dan Dreesen. Dan Dreesen was the first baseman because Ken at that time was only an outfielder.
Tom enjoying retirement. Connecticut plays a lot of golf with Ralph Kiner. Looking at Jones. Jack Lang told a story before about Cleon when Gil Hodges went out to left field. I bet that was the only time in history that happened, where the manager walked all the way out to the outfield, took the player out. And there's a base hit in the right field. And here's Art Shamsky with the bat in his hand now. Art, the owner of a restaurant with Ron Darling, Tony Ferraro, Murray Street. They're going to change the name to Legends. And there's a base hit. So Sham getting the hit. Got some big hits in game two of the 69 championship series against the Braves. I'm talking about Art Shamsky. And Al Weiss.
Art Shamsky hit four home runs consecutively over two games. Three in one game, one in another. I think that ties a major league record. I think Ralph did it over two games.
I wouldn't be surprised.
One time.
And Al Weiss pops the ball up in the infield. You know, Al Weiss played an important role in Frank Robinson's career. When Robinson won the Triple Crown, the following year, he was having a better season. And I guess it was around the latter part of May.
Yeah.
The latter part of May, Frank Robinson was known as the hardest slider in the American League. He slid into second base to break up a double play and was injured when he made contact with Al Weiss. And he had double vision. Wasn't the same after that for the whole season. And Wayne Garrett. Huckleberry Finn type character, isn't he? Right out of a Huckleberry Finn story. Should have a fishing pole. Walking down the Mississippi.
Ron Howard.
Yeah, Ron Howard. Looks a lot like Ron Howard. And there's a base hit, and Cleon Jones is heading to the plate. No play. I believe if they threw the ball, there would have been a collision.
Opie. Opie ropes one to the right. Ron Howard, a marvelous movie producer now, a director.
He do Splash?
Yep, Cocoon.
Cocoon?
And Cocoon 2 is coming out around Christmas, I think.
Popped up, now Randy Hundley is under it, and one hands it, of course.
2 men down.
When you see it, you usually see a young catcher doing that backpedaling. They've gone too far under, ball like that. It's happened to every catcher at one time or another. Could Alvin have a hack?
You know, Alvin's been swinging the bat down in the minor leagues. He works for the Mets. He was a fine pitcher.
He might have made a mine in 1967, as you saw.
It's a ground ball. Of course, he still talks about the home run that he gave up to Willie McCovey.
In 66, I called it. Boy, did that thing go
What long. Was the longest home run you ever called?
That one?
That one,
oh,
it was.
Yeah, that it was. Yeah. They're called Bunning's home run to Stargell, and the Mets will be at Veterans Stadium Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, and we'll have two of those games on Sports Channel Tuesday and Wednesday night.
And the old timers are...
Winston Churchill once said of Russia, "It is a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma." If he were alive today, Churchill might well have been speaking instead of the 1988 New York Mets. Who were the 1988 Mets? Were they the team that so convincingly won the National League East by 15 games? Or the team that lost the playoffs in seven tough games to the Los Angeles Dodgers? Were they the team that started the season with a 30-11 record? Or the team that played 500 ball throughout the long, hot summer? In the final analysis, the 1988 Mets were a successful team, a team that continued its five-year tradition of excellence, a team that met challenge after challenge and came up with 100 winning ways. The story of the 1988 New York Mets, sponsored by WFAN Sports Radio, 66 AM. The New York Mets began spring training 88 in a beautiful new state-of-the-art facility in Port St. Lucie, Florida. Sightseeing, however, soon gave way to hard work, as the 1988 Mets were clearly intent on making up for their disappointing second-place finish in 1987. This time, Dwight Gooden was with the team from the beginning. While Kevin Elster was hoping to live up to his shortstop of the future billing, the veterans, too, looked hungry and more than ready for the 1988 season. The first game of the 1988 National League season took place in Montreal, and after former Met and Expo legend Rusty Staub threw out the ceremonial first pitch, the Mets showed they were indeed ready for 88. Especially Dwight Gooden, who needed to prove he was capable of being the Dwight Gooden of old. And Kevin Elster, who just needed to prove he could play shortstop. Then there was Darryl Strawberry.
It's a high fly, hit deep to center, way back, going, going, gone!
The Mets hit a club record six homers in their 10-6 rout of the Expos, including one which nearly tore the roof off Olympic Stadium that came off the bat of Darryl Strawberry.
A high fly ball deep to right field, way up off the roof! It hit the roof! It hit the roof of Olympic Stadium, bounced down into right center field. It is a home run.
Not only was the home run barrage impressive to watch, it also got the Mets going in the right direction.
Yeah, I feel that, after last season, it was very important for us to come out of the box this year real quick. I think we had a lot of things to prove personally as well as the whole team. It's a funny thing about baseball. That's probably one of the reasons why, you know, last year we had a lot of problems, a lot of injuries. Everybody expected us to repeat. I think we all had a lot of personal goals we had to come back and work a little harder for this year.
Deep to left. Gibson back. Out of here! Home run, Kevin Elster! I don't believe it!
Well, we felt that getting up to a quick start was very important to the ball club because the year before in 87, we had a lot of injuries. And after being there in 86, seeing what it was like, it makes you want to, scrap even harder and get back again. And so everybody just pulled together, got to know each other a lot better, work hard, puff each other on and off the field, and came together great as a team.
The expectations are so high, so a lot of times the pressure is so great. But coming out of shoot like we did, we didn't really play good the first week. But then we turned it on, the pitching and the hitting. We were averaging like 5 runs a game and ran up that great lead.
Swung on, hit in the air to left field. He got a pretty good ride. Palmeiro going back, way back, way back. Goodbye, home run. The sucker's over.
We believed in ourselves, and we were able to come back. I think that showed that also to ourselves as well as everybody else that this is our year. And, you know, you just gain confidence when those things happen.
Deep to center. Out of here, home run! Howard Johnson wins it for the Mets in the bottom of the 13th inning. Oh, brother, what a ball game.
You got to want to win. But not only do you have to want to win, you've got to have the talent there and the players there to be able to do it with.
Early on, the most talented of those players was clearly Darryl Strawberry. In fact, 1988 was definitely the year Darryl Strawberry came of age. He led the National League with 39 homers and drove in more than 100 runs for the second consecutive year as he finished second in the most valuable player balloting. Yes, Darryl became a team leader in 1988, a complete ball player who matured tremendously in his sixth major league season.
I think players get more comfortable after, you know, going around the league and experiencing the major leagues, and you start maturing. The key to my success is being very confident in myself and believing, you know, that I can put up some big numbers. I figured it was just a matter of time before things start happening.
Bottom of the 10th inning, and a drive to deep right field. It's going, going, it is gone, goodbye. And the Mets win it on Strawberry's two-run home run in the 10th inning.
Unfortunately, as great as Darryl was, he couldn't do it alone. And ultimately, the Mets couldn't maintain their blazing start. Beginning in June, they began a slump that would last nearly the entire summer.
I think it's probably one of the hottest summers that we have played in. And it might have had an effect on the overall statistics and averages of this year, you know, because they are way down in the National League, and I just don't think. I mean, all credit due to the pitchers wherever possible, but I don't think the pitchers improved that much over 1 year.
Whatever it was, the Mets struggled throughout the summer, and nowhere was that more in evidence than with Gary Carter's pursuit of his 300th home run. A quest that seemed so simple, yet seemed to go on forever. After hitting 8 homers in the first month and a half of the season, Carter went ice cold during a red-hot summer. And although there would be times when he'd come close, Gary would eventually go almost 3 months between homers. Add to that the disabling hamstring injury that Keith Hernandez suffered in early June, and you begin to see why the Mets had a problem. Keith wound up missing 2 full months, and with him out of the lineup and Carter slumping, the Mets had to look to others to help pick them up and get them going in the right direction. One of those others came through in a big way on June 21st. That night, Darryl Strawberry was walked intentionally to load the bases in a scoreless game against the Pittsburgh Pirates. The Pirates felt that Doug Drabeck could get past Kevin McReynolds, but McReynolds was ready for the challenge.
It's a drive! It's Drabeck! It's gone! A grand slam home run by Kevin McReynolds!
By late June, it was apparent that the Pirates would be the team the Mets had to beat to win the East. So they simply went out and beat them.
They were still winning. We were still doing the things that we needed to do to keep us on top of the race. And I think that's the mark of a good ball club, that we can do whatever we need to win. We can win a game 13-10, 13-12, or we can win a game 1-0.
Against the Pirates, that's exactly what the Mets did. First, they took 2 out of 3 in New York, shutting out the Pirates 3-0 and 9-0. And then when the two teams moved to Pittsburgh a week later, the Mets took 2 out of 3 again.
Deep to left field is Elster. Back is Bonds. This ball is out of here. Home run, Kevin Elster.
After splitting the first two games, the Mets won the third dramatically after tying the game with 2 outs and 2 strikes in the ninth, courtesy of a Howard Johnson homer.
High and deep to right, way back. Reynolds at the wall, it is gone. Howard Johnson ties the game.
I think it sent a message to that ball club that, you know, Pittsburgh is a good team, but you're just not ready yet, you know, to compete with us over long haul.
Grounder towards second. Tuffle. Elster. Quickly turned, double play, and the Mets win it. And I'll tell you, at year's end, they're going to point to this game as one of the key ball games of the year.
One of the key reasons the Mets were able to achieve 100 wins in 88 was Kevin McReynolds, who gave new meaning to the phrase, speak softly, but carry a big stick. In 1988, McReynolds not only hit 27 homers and drove in 99 runs, he also went the entire season without being thrown out stealing and led the National League with two grand slams, one of which came at Wrigley Field with two outs in the ninth and the Mets trailing the Chicago Cubs 7-5.
A high fly ball to center field. Webster going back. Grand slam, home run, Kevin McReynolds.
McReynolds just was doing his thing, just consistently. You don't notice him being there. He's the best all-around player on the field. He plays defense, runs the bases. His instincts on the ball diamond are better than anybody on the ball club.
Nowhere was that more apparent than in left field, where McReynolds proved that he was more than just a good hitter. He played his position as well as anyone in the game, and his 18 assists was tops for an outfielder in the National League.
For me, it's all in the preparation of having my step down when I get the ball, getting rid of it in two steps or less. If you take three or four steps once you get to the ball, that gives the runner another couple of steps. And if you can cut it down to one or two steps, you've got a much greater chance of throwing a guy out. You know, the key to the game is to score more runs than the other team does. And one way you can keep the other team from scoring is with defense. And I take as much pride in my defense as I do in my hitting.
Whether he was throwing them out or hitting them out, by any standard, Kevin McReynolds had quite a year in 1988. The same could be said of the Mets pitching staff, which dominated the National League in 1988, returning to the form, which saw them lead the Mets to a World Championship in 1986.
The starters, we talked to him in the spring about let's complete more ball games. Let's be the kind of pitching staff that you cracked up to be in 86, you were hurt in 87, and let's do the things this year you're capable of.
In 1988, Dwight Gooden demonstrated that he was capable once again of becoming the workhorse of the staff, leading the team with 248 innings pitched while winning 18 games. Then there was Ron Darling, who finished the year with a career high of 17 wins and four shutouts. Sid Fernandez finished strong, too. After losing five of his first seven, Sid completed 1988 with a 12-10 record and a 3.03 ERA. Bobby Ojeda also pitched well, finishing with 10 wins and a 2.88 ERA that included a team-high five shutouts. But the star of the staff was clearly David Cohn, who became only the fourth Met in team history to win 20 games. What made Cohn's remarkable 20-3 record even more amazing was that he didn't even become a starter until May 3rd.
Well, I kind of felt coming out of spring training that there was going to be a need for me to fill any type of role, be kind of a swing man, get a few spot starts, help out in middle relief, maybe a little bit of short relief to spell Roger and Randy. And that was my attitude, just help the club out in any way I can. And unfortunately for Rick Aguilera, you know, he had the elbow problem, and I stepped in, and I just wanted to take advantage of an opportunity.
He's just put it all together in a short period of time. It's one of the things that can happen, I think, with a pitcher. It usually doesn't happen with an everyday player. A pitcher can put everything together real quick and go from just a regular pitcher to becoming a star, and that's what David Cohn has done.
A star, yes, and despite his baby face looks, a pitcher as tough as they come.
I think what really counts is what's down inside, the intensity, and what you have, you know, as far as guts go. And that's something that doesn't come out in as far as physical appearance.
No, I'm no angel. No, I'm no stranger to the streets. I've got my label, so I won't crumble at your feet. And I know
course, the Mets starters didn't do it alone in 88. Whenever Davey had to go to the bullpen usually came through. There was Rick Aguilera, who successfully came back from elbow surgery at the end of the season, and Terry Leach, who followed his spectacular 87 season by going 7-2 in 88. For short relief, there was Roger McDowell, who not only pitched well with 16 saves, but also pitched in with some comic relief.
He's a unique individual. He, you know, every day is something different, and you know, everybody kind of looks forward to what he's going to do next.
My main target usually is Bill Robinson. He's very easy to get. I remember one time earlier this year at the beginning of the season, I got him with a hot foot, and he made a bet with me that he would, or that I would never get him again through the course of the season. I got him the next night.
Those who know the Mets know McDowell's practical jokes don't stop at hot foots. This is a man with a virtual arsenal of props and gags. But in 88, Roger even tried something new to him, making home movies.
Hi, everybody. Sitting at home watching this movie. Bored out of your gourd, but having me fly. Sit there and watch Roger Snake.
Randy Myers gave McDowell any competition when it came to being wacky, although their styles did differ somewhat. While McDowell was always loose as could be, Myers was as intense as they came.
He's different crazy than I am. He is crazy, military crazy. He's one person that you don't want to cross or play a practical joke on because he might get out one of those ninja stars and throw it at you and you're done.
My job is to get guys out. As a reliever or as a starter, you have a job to do, and I like to go about and try to do my job. I wasn't raised a loser, I was raised a winner, and I gotta go out and every time go out and, you know, do the best I can. And you're gonna make mistakes, but if you have a bad game, you gotta get right back out there, and that's, you know, manager's job is to get you back out there.
In 1988, Myers got out there in 29 save opportunities and saved 26 of them, while finishing with a team-low ERA of 1.72, establishing himself along the way as the premier left-handed stopper in baseball. Excellent pitching has always been a Mets tradition. And on July the 24th, the team took time to honor Tom Seaver and retire the number of perhaps the greatest pitcher ever to wear a Met uniform.
I'm going to say thank you in my own very special way. And if you know me, how much I love pitching, you'll know what it means to me.
What a wonderful way to link the past with the present, and in the process, celebrate a tradition of excellence that has marked the franchise with baseball's winningest ways of the past 5 years.
Roy Gooden has set a new Major League record for strikeouts by a rookie pitcher.
Curve, well hit, deep to left field. Way back, it may go. It is at the top of the wall. Gone, a home run, a home run. Gary Carter wins it. Now the pitch on the way. He struck him out, struck him out. The Mets have won the World Series. And they're crowd jamming and crowding all over Jesse Orasco.
Errol Strawberry, a member of the 30-30 Club. He becomes the ninth man to join that exclusive club. And he joins Howard Johnson of the Mets.
They now have set a club record. They've set a major league record for the most home runs hit by a team on opening day.
Over the years, Shea Stadium has been the home of many memorable moments. And now celebrating its 25th anniversary, Shea never looked better. And down the stretch in 88, neither did the Mets. When their lead over the Pirates dwindled to just a few games in August, the Mets simply beat Pittsburgh in 6 of 8 crucial games, one of which saw Keith Hernandez return to action.
3-0 pitch, it deep to right field. It is gone. Goodbye. Keith Hernandez, welcome back.
August also saw the end of Gary Carter's quest for his 300th home run, which came on August 11th at Wrigley Field.
It is in the air. Will it go? It is going, going, and it is gone. Goodbye. 300th home run, finally.
I come across home plate. Howard Johnson was on the on-deck circle, and he had this big smile like he was having a heart attack, and I kind of went the same way, and it was just a big relief. And fortunately, the fan was coaxed into throwing it back on the field, so I have that proud souvenir of my 300th home run.
With Pittsburgh put away, the Mets faced a final challenge from the Montreal Expos, but the Mets had an answer for them, too.
And he drives one. But here comes Martinez. He makes the catch. Here comes Johnson and the throw. He wins the game. Johnson scores, and the Mets win it 4-3.
Never during the season have we relied on anybody else to fight our battles. Whenever Pittsburgh challenged us, we beat them head-to-head. When Montreal challenged us, we beat them. Since that point, we never looked back.
From that point on, the Mets got hot again, winning 30 of their last 42, showing the dominance they displayed for so much of the early part of the season.
We rose to the occasion. We got hot in late August in Los Angeles. We swept LA. And like, you know, we never did a tight pennant race. The team that wins in September within the division is the team that wins it, and we certainly had a great September, so I got to feel that we rose to the occasion.
Change up hit deep to right. Back is Crook. This ball is out of here. Home run, Keith Hernandez. 4-0, New York.
All good clubs finish strong, and generally it's picked up in August. We didn't really pick it up in August. We were kind of a 500 club in August. And I think we had to win 4 or 5 games at the end of August to be a 500 club, or a little better than 500 club in August. September was the month where really the pitching and everything came together.
Swung on deep to right field. Dawson to the wall.
Our pitchers has kept us there all year. We have to give them the credit for keeping us right in the middle of that pennant race. And then when the offense got rolling in September, it just, you know, really picked up everything that we were missing. And then Greg Jeffries came up and he, you know, played a big part of it, you know, getting the offense going, hitting the number two spot, where he made more opportunities happen for me and Keith. And I think that made a big difference how the offense turned around.
It's doubtful that any rookie in the history of the Mets franchise made as much of an immediate impact as Greg Jeffries. After just 2 weeks in the majors, Jeffries was named the National League's Player of the Week and was already showing the veterans a thing or two.
Get deep to left field, way back, and this ball is out of here. Home run, Greg Jeffries.
I just always try to hustle. That's all I want to do. I want to put in 110%, and I just... I feel I need to do that to be a decent player. If I kind of be lackadaisical, I feel I'm gonna make a lot of mistakes. So I just try to hustle as much as I can. It's just the way I'm brought up, just hustling, and I play at a high level intensity, and it's in my genes, I guess. I don't really know how to explain it, but I just play with a lot of hustle.
A lot of hustle might be an understatement. Jeffries sparked a fire under the Mets that really got them going, and by late September, the race with the Pirates and the Expos was all but over. But before the Mets could clinch the division, misfortune struck. Bobby Ojeda severely cut a finger on his pitching hand and was forced to miss the rest of the season. Ojeda's injury was still fresh in everyone's mind when the night came for the Mets to clinch their second National League Eastern Division title in 3 years. That happened on September 22nd. And although the feeling of exuberance was tempered, there was still plenty of it going around.
He gave it to him. Strike three, ball game over. New York Mets win the National League Eastern Division crown the second time in 3 years.
So it was on to the National League playoffs, where the heavily favored Mets would face the Los Angeles Dodgers. In Game 1, the Dodgers sent Oral Hershiser to the mound, and as he had done in his previous 59 innings, Hershiser held the Mets scoreless into the ninth. Fortunately, Dwight Gooden was pitching as well as Hershiser. Still, the Dodgers led 2-0 until one out in the ninth, when the Mets finally got something going.
And it's a line drive base hit going into right center field. Jeffries around third is scoring, and
Soon Hershiser was gone, and for the Dodgers, so was the game.
Short center field, coming quickly, Shelby diving, can't get it. Here's the throw coming to the plate. A collision at the plate, the run is in. Mets have the lead. Mets have the lead.
Things, however, didn't go so well in Game 2. David Cone was hit early and often, and on this night, there would be no miracle finish as the Dodgers held on for a 6-3 win. So the series shifted to Shea for Game 3, and while the weather wasn't so great, at least the game was. Fantastic plays and controversy marked the afternoon as the Mets scored 5 times in the 8th for another come-from-behind win. Ultimately, the Mets' magic would end in Game 4. After falling behind 2-0 in the first, Darryl Strawberry tied the game with a 2-run homer in the 4th. One batter later, Kevin McReynolds followed with a homer of his own, and the Mets had a 3-2 lead, which they eventually increased to 4-2 going into the ninth. The Mets looked to be a lock to go up 3-1 in the series, especially with Gooden cruising on the mound, not having given up a hit since the first. But John Shelby worked out a walk after falling behind in the count 0-2. And then Mike Socha delivered the blow that would ultimately cripple the Mets.
Well hit drive deep to right field, way back. It may go out of here. It's gone. It's gone. The game is tied up. The Dodgers have tied it up.
Mike Socha's dramatic 2-run homer sent the game into extra innings, where Kirk Gibson's homer in the 12th won it. Less than 14 hours later, Los Angeles won big again. David Cone redeemed himself by winning Game 6 in Los Angeles as the Mets cruised to a 5-1 win. But in Game 7, the Mets would be shut out by the incomparable Hershiser. A season that held so much promise was surprisingly and abruptly over. In the final analysis, how could you sum up 1988? By most accounts, it was a very successful year. A year of winning, a year of memories, and a year of milestones. Darryl Strawberry became the Mets' all-time home run leader, and Dwight Gooden recorded the 1,000th strikeout of his young but already brilliant career. Mookie Wilson came away with career hit 1,000 and also became the Mets' all-time leader in runs scored. Then there was Gary Carter's 300th home run, hit during his 12th straight year of catching more than 100 games, just one season short of the Major League record. And how about David Cone, whose 20-3 record ranked as the 6th best in baseball history for pitchers with 20 or more wins in a season? And finally, let's not forget the 3 million plus fans who poured into Shea to witness it all, including the 5th straight season in which Davey Johnson won more than 90 games. Yes, The Mets came within one game of going to the World Series and missed, and that hurt. But it was also a team which proved it could win again and again and again, and will be a winner again in 1989 as the Mets' tradition of excellence continues.
If I had to be one other person for a season, I'd probably like to be Darryl Strawberry.
David Cone.
Why?
He's got a great future. I wouldn't want to come back as a hitter. I'd want to try as a pitcher.
Really?
Yeah. I'd just rather try as a pitcher, starting pitcher. I think it'd be fun. Have 4 days off in between. Can relax, not play every day. I think it'd be sweet.
One of the millionaires. One of the 20 millionaires in this team I'd like to be.
I'll say Darryl. Just, you know, the way he hits the ball, and coming up as a kid, I always wanted to be a hitter. And just to, you know, hit 30 home runs plus a year and try to run the bases would be great.
I've never caught, except in, you know, real little league, and that doesn't count. And I think it would be interesting to go back there with the mask and the protector and the shin guards and see what it's all about and try not to blink when the guy swings.
To me, I think Mookie Wilson is probably the greatest Mets player ever played, so I don't think it would be anyone else. But if I had to, for the sake of argument, if I had to be another ball player, I would have to say I would like to be Darryl Strawberry.
I probably would want to be Davey Johnson, the manager, because I think he's sitting in a good good situation where, you know, he's probably the winningest manager over the last 5 years. So I would like to be in a situation like Davey Johnson at this particular point.
Well, you know, I know them all, and if I could be one other guy, I wouldn't pick any of them.
New York's most entertaining sports team has moved to 66 on your AM dial.
I miss in the morning, WFAN.
I miss, you don't know anything about sports. Why don't you get off the radio?
Oh, hi, Pete. Pete Franklin, afternoons here at WFAN.
Great, you don't know a pickoff from a kickoff, a bunt from a punt. The Mets from the Jets.
Oh, yeah, well, ask my close personal friend, Daryl Raspberry.
Raspberry, it's Strawberry Dum-Dum.
You don't have to be a sports nut to enjoy New York's most entertaining sports team on the new Sports Radio 66 AM, WFAN.
Out there.